Good morning, class, including our latest orphan. My name is Mr. Remora, and today, for Language Arts, I will continue telling anecdotes from my own life that I find amusing. You'll take notes, and later on, there will be a test. Okay, now one day, I think it was a Tuesday, I was in the mood for macaroni and cheese, so I said to myself today, Tuesday, I think I'll have some macaroni and cheese. It's important to remember it wasn't apple macaroni or decorated butterfly.
Good morning, children. May I have your undivided attention?
Well, luckily, you would never have a class like that. Your teacher tells only clever, meaningful anecdotes that relate, you know, completely and in every way to what you're doing. Right? Right. All right, so I'm away again today, guys. It'll probably be the last time I'm away for a while. So I want to quickly just teach you a lesson. But before we do that, I want to take up a couple of pieces of homework, if I can. So step one is going to be taking up some homework. And yeah, let's do that, shall we? So from lesson 3.3, which is a couple days ago, I want to just look at a couple of questions from the end and see how we're doing there, shall we? So I asked you to calculate the enthalpy change. Oh my, sorry about that. To calculate the enthalpy change, I'm just going to make this so I can see it. For the vaporization of water. Specifically for the vaporization of 150 grams of water. And in this case, we're going to talk about liquid water becoming gaseous water. And we should know that that is going to be an input of energy. So we're going to have to put energy into this system. Because we know that when we take liquid water and we boil it to make gaseous water, that involves putting energy in. So let's try this out. And the first thing I would say is that we need the equation. And we already have that up above. If you wanted to write it as a chemical equation, we would say H2O as a liquid plus delta H yields H2O in the gaseous phase. And that's what we're going to do. Now, to do this specifically, we want to look at 150 grams of water. And just keep in mind that I always kind of like to map this out, which is we are going to start with a mass of water measured in grams. And from that mass, as we discussed yesterday, we should be able to figure out how many moles of water we have. And then we should be able to look at our chart and we should be able to know how much each mole of water, how much energy is required for that. So we should be able to go from moles of water then to energy, specifically heat energy, and that will be measured in joules. So with that in mind, let's take a look, because once we've done that, we can go back and look at the molar enthalpy of vaporization. And here we're vaporizing water. And so we will know that when we take liquid water and we vaporize it, it requires 40.8 kilojoules of energy per mole. So let's give this a try. We know that we have 150 grams of H2O, and that is our starting point. So 150 grams of water. And with dimensional analysis, we are always going to multiply by a fraction. So we start with 150 grams of water. And the first thing we want to know is that we are always going to work in moles. This should be reminiscent of grade 11. We did a lot of this in grade 11, obviously, those of you I taught. And for those of you whom I didn't teach, hopefully you know that as a rule, go to moles. Moles is your central unit. So we are going to cancel grams of water and instead work with moles of water. And here, we're going to need numbers to make this true. So 1 mole of water weighs how much? And this is something that you can look up on the periodic table. I am going to use numbers as I remember them. So we can say that the molar mass of water should be relatively easy to calculate because it's H2O. So we have two hydrogens, 1.00794 grams per mole, and an oxygen, which is 15.9994 grams per mole. And I should be careful to make that clearly uppercase, because molar mass is an uppercase M. The molar mass of H2O is, let's just do this. I should be able to do this in my head, but I'm not going to try to, because I will screw it up. So instead, let's just do it right here. Eighteen decimal zero one five two eight grams per mole. And I can use this information here. I can say that 1 mole of water weighs 18.01528 grams per mole. And grams of water will cancel with grams of water. And if I were to stop calculating now, I would know how many moles of water I have. But, and I want to get in this habit, if we aren't already, let's just keep going. There's no reason to do this as two separate calculations. We can just carry on. Because now, I don't want moles of water. I want joules of energy. And actually, when we go look at the chart, I think we're going to find it's in kilojoules. So let's go back up and check. And sure enough, to vaporize water is 40.8 kilojoules of energy for every mole. So we can come down here and we can say 40.8 kilojoules for every 1 mole of water. And now we have a set of calculations that we can actually do. And remember that when we are multiplying by a fraction, we need to multiply and divide. This is fairly trivial stuff. So we start with our 150, and we multiply it by 1, and we divide it by 18.01528, and we multiply it by 40.8, and we divide it by 1. So you do the same in your calculator, and when I do that, I get 339.71162. And if we look at our units, moles is also canceled with moles, and the unit that remains should be kilojoules of energy. There we go. We are ready to answer the actual question. Before we do that, I just want to take a look at one thing, which you should all be screaming at me, and no doubt you are, and I just didn't notice, which is significant figures. And so if we look here, this number here is only giving me two significant figures, because that zero is sketchy. We don't know if it's one sig figure two. Or two sig figs or three, rather. So we have to assume it's two. Remember that any counting number is infinite. So that one is infinite. We don't have to worry about. This gives me lots. My molar mass is always due. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 sig figs. This one is also infinite. Again, it's a counting number. And 40.8, remember that zeros in the middle have to be significant. It's only zeros at the beginning or at the end that you really have to think about. Any number in the middle counts. So this is the 4, the 0, and the 8 that are significant. So 3 sig figs. And so we always take the least, which means we need to re-express this answer to only 2 sig figs. Which means that the 2, the 6, the 1, the 1, the 7, and the 9 are all non-significant, and we need to round to this digit. And that means we can say that delta H is just 340 kilojoules. And lastly, last thing to think about is direction. Is this a positive delta H or a negative delta H? Remember, we said if energy is released, it's negative. And if energy is put into the system, it's positive. So in this case, it is positive. And we normally wouldn't actually put a positive sign with a positive delta H, but just to prove a point, I'm going to put it there. Some of you may prefer scientific notation. Nothing wrong with that. 3.4 times 10 to the 2 kilojoules. Just like that. All right, and we could even say, therefore, 340 kilojoules of heat energy are absorbed in this reaction. And there we go. So that is how we would approach a question like that. It's going to take a bit of practice. Now, you're going to get your first assignment package of this unit tomorrow, and it's going to have a bunch of questions like this. So if you still feel a little stressed out by it, I don't want you to worry about it, because you're going to get lots more practice. I'm going to go through a couple of these questions here, too. If you guys are feeling great about them and you just want to skip to the lesson, you can do so. But yeah, I'm gonna go through just one or two, just to make sure we're on the same page. So how many moles of sodium hydroxide weigh 18.7 grams? If you haven't already done this question as a group, maybe you can pause and make sure everyone's done it, give it a try, and then we'll take it up. All right, we're all back. So how many moles of sodium hydroxide? Well, the first thing you have to do, I suppose, is figure out what sodium hydroxide is. And of course, sodium is the Na ion, which if you look at the periodic table, it's in group 1. So it should take a charge of, that's right, plus 1. And hydroxide is OH minus, which you can look up on your chart. So a sodium ion and a hydroxide ion. Sodium takes a charge of positive 1. Hydroxide takes a charge of negative 1. Those charge balance one another nicely. So the formula should be Zach Brown. That is correct. See, I assumed you got it right. I hope you didn't let me down, Zach Brown. Though if you did, that's okay too. Our formula is NaOH. That's sodium hydroxide. So, with that in mind, we could say I have 18.7 grams of sodium hydroxide. And, as always, when we're doing a question like this, we'll do dimensional analysis. We're going to put the unit we want to cancel on the bottom. That is Jade bar. Correct. Grams of sodium hydroxide. Just like that. And the unit on the top? Kevin? Yeah, moles of sodium hydroxide. And now we have to work out the molar mass. Hey, Cortana. Hey, Cortana. What's the molar mass of sodium hydroxide?
Here is what I found.
The average molar mass of the chemical compound sodium hydroxide is 39.997 grams per mole.
Okay, so you can't do that, of course, but I can. So there we go. 39.997 grams per mole. And of course, you could have just looked that up on the periodic table. But once we've done that, we can just do this calculation. 18.7 grams times 1 over... Oh, it doesn't know grams. 18.7 times 1 divided by 39.997. And when we do that, we get 0.4675. And what unit will that be? Because units are important. Well, grams of sodium hydroxide cancels with grams of sodium hydroxide. The unit that remains is moles of sodium hydroxide. And I'm done, and it's perfect, and that's exactly the right answer, right? Fine. Alondra's right, which is that we have to look at significant digits. And if we look here, this has how many? Avery. I'm going to assume you didn't say anything snide because you would never do that. This has 3 sig figs, correct? This one, how many? Oh, it must just be 1 sig fig. Oh, that's right, Caleb. Any counting number is always infinite. It's got as many sig figs as it needs to have. And 39.997 is, of course, 5 sig figs. Which means that my answer should have the least, which is 3. And so that 5 is going to cancel, and we are going to round to that 7. And because this is exactly 0.5, when it's exactly 0.5 after, we round to favor. Does anyone remember? This is an esoteric rule. But we round to favor the even number. And that is only if it is precisely and exactly 5. Not just the next digit, but there can't be any digits after that. It's only if it's exactly 5 that the rule is just to always favor the even number, not the odd number. And there we go. Should we do one more? I think you're okay. I think we can take up more tomorrow. And we will get on to today's lesson. So for those of you keeping score at home, that is Mr. Orlando 2, Chemistry 0. We're in good shape there. And we can get on to today's note. Now, today's note is a pretty straightforward one. I don't think you're going to have a lot of trouble with it. It is about representing specific changes in enthalpy. So we have been talking about enthalpy changes. Oh, that's not better, but okay. We've been talking about enthalpy changes, and if you remember, enthalpy is a measure of the total amount of energy inside of a molecule. And most of that energy is stored inside the bonds of those molecules. We can't measure that energy. Certainly not with the technology available to us in a 4U chemistry class in Welland, Ontario, in the District School Board of Niagara. We don't have, you know, quantum equipment to figure out crazy things. So we can't measure overall enthalpy, but we can measure, and we will measure, changes in enthalpy. So let's take a look at that. That's today's note, which hopefully has been handed out to you. Lesson 3.4, representing enthalpy changes. And the three main ways that we show changes in enthalpy. And I just want to go through them. Just the three ways that we could show. So first and foremost, it's important to remember that when we talk about enthalpy, we are talking about really two possible changes, right? Which is to say we could have endothermic reactions and we could have exothermic reactions. And it's an important thing that we know the difference between them. All right, so as a reminder, an endothermic reaction, endo means, let's say, Zach Brown. That's right, endothermic means inside the molecule. So endothermic is when heat is absorbed. Exothermic, exo means outside, thermo, heat, means that heat is released by the reaction. So, particularly when we look here, we need ways to show that heat is either absorbed or to show that heat is released. And we need a good effective way to show both of these things, and so to switch between them. So, let's take a look at that. The first way is one that you've already seen, which is what we call a thermochemical equation. And this you have already seen. It's just the chemical reaction the way you would always write it, but you include the energy in the chemical equation. And if energy is released, if we end up with energy at the end of the reaction, well, then that's one of the products. So we put that energy in the product side. And if energy absorbs, well, then it needed it to begin with. And so we're going to put it on the reactant side. And just note that if you use more than one mole of reactant, you're going to need to multiply the enthalpy as well. And you're going to see that. So you're going to balance a chemical equation and make sure it works. So let's look at an example. The enthalpy of burning ethanol is 726 kilojoules per mole. And this is an exothermic reaction. So ethanol, I'll give you a moment to write the formula for that. That is, of course, from our last unit. You should be able to do that. Let's take a minute. Ethanol. Eth means the chain is two carbons long. All means that it is an alcohol is correct. So there we go. And H. So there we go. So what's the formula for that? Well, it's C2H1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I'm not going to put that H on there. I'm going to mark that differently. I'm going to call this C2H5OH. I want you to note it would be just as correct to write C2H6O, but this gives me a sense of the structure. This is a pretty common thing when naming alcohols, that we write the OH separately so that we can see just by eyeballing it that it is an alcohol. So we would say C2H5OH is going to react with what? Well, what does it mean to burn something? What does it mean to burn something? Well, when you burn a hydrocarbon, you are reacting it with anyone? Oxygen. Oxygen is correct. Now I'm going to leave a little bit of space because we're going to have to balance this guy at some point. And we should put our states of matter in here. Ethanol at room temperature. It's small. So its London dispersion forces are small. Oh, but it's got that OH, and that will give us, of course, hydrogen bonding. So it's going to be fairly strong van der Waals forces. This is a liquid at room temperature. Oxygen is gaseous at room temperature. And when these react. Now, I didn't leave room for energy over here, because if you look, this is negative. And negative means that this must be what kind of reaction? Dana Thompson. That is entirely correct. It's got to be exothermic. Heat's got to be released. By the way, we know this. When we burn things, they produce heat. Heat is released. It doesn't get cold. So the heat is going to be somewhere over here. Now, what are the products when we burn a hydrocarbon? Well, let's assume it burns completely. Complete combustion. It should give us, Sierra? Yeah, that's right. It's going to give us carbon dioxide. And again, I'm going to leave myself a bit of space for balancing. Carbon dioxide, use up all those carbons. And we've got to use up all the hydrogens. So, and water. And because we're at temperature, these will probably both be gases when they get produced. And it's going to release 726 kilojoules. Right? For every 1 mole of this I use, I get 726 kilojoules. We may have to double or triple this number if we have to double or triple this. Let's see when we balance it. So you take a minute and try and balance that out. See what you get. Pause the video and just see what you get. Whoa, why am I doing that? Okay. So let's take a look. If we go to balance this thing, the first thing I would note is that I have two carbons here. And if I have two carbons there, to make it balance, I'm going to have to put two carbons here. So that's my first thought. My next thought is that I've got five, and one more makes 6 hydrogens on this side. And so to make that work, since this is H2O, I'm going to need 3 of them. So now carbon works. 2 carbons, 2 carbons, 5 hydrogens, or sorry, 6 hydrogens, 6 hydrogens, that's good. And now we need to count oxygens and make them work. So over here we have 3 oxygens. And then there's 2 here times 2 for 4. So we have a total of 7 oxygens over here. And then over here, we have 1. And then we've got 2 more. So if I want to get to 7, I don't want to multiply this thing. I mean, I guess I could multiply this by like 5, and that would do it. But that would mess everything else up. So I want to think, what number could I put here? Well, if I put a 3 here, then I would be in pretty good shape. Because with a 3 there, I'll do it the same color as everything else. This 2 now becomes a 6, and 1 and 6 is 7, and we have 7 on each side. And there we are. We're balanced. That is our thermochemical equation. So C2H5OH, liquid, plus 3O2 gas yields 2CO2 gas plus 3H2O plus 726 kilojoules. Now keep in mind that if we were to double this, we would have to double that as well. So say, to make it balance, I'd had to put a 2 in front. And I had to say 2C2H5OH, liquid, plus 6O2 yields CO2 and water. These numbers would have had to be 4 and 6. And now this number would have had to double as well. Because if we double how much ethanol is burned, we double how much ethanol is going to produce heat. And that would be, 1452, I believe. And there we go. Now, keep in mind, this didn't need to be doubled to balance, but there will come times when it is. So a thermochemical equation can be done that includes that heat energy, and that is a perfectly appropriate way to show a reaction. The second way we can do this is a thermochemical equation, but this time we don't write the energy in. This time we write the thermochemical equation, and next to it we just say what delta H is. We just announce it. So you can write a thermochemical equation and then write the delta H value right beside it. Now, if you do this, you have to remember whether delta H is negative or whether delta H is positive. So let's do an example of this. Sulfur dioxide and oxygen react to form sulfur trioxide. The molar enthalpy for the combustion of sulfur dioxide is negative 98.9 kilojoules per mole. What's the enthalpy change for this reaction? So do me a favor. First things first, write the chemical equation and balance it. Write the chemical equation and balance it. You can pause this video and let's everyone take a try to do that. All right, and we are all back. So let's take a look at this. Sulfur dioxide and oxygen react. So sulfur dioxide, it's right in the name, SO2. And I happen to know that's a gas. Reacts with oxygen gas. And I may have to balance this, so I should leave a little room, shouldn't I? And they are going to react to form SO3. And that happens to be a gas as well. Keep in mind, by the way, this is not the sulfite ion. There's no charge or anything like that. Sulfur trioxide, in this case, is a stable organic molecule. So there it is. Now, this isn't balanced. And unfortunately, I have an odd number of oxygens here. And odd numbers tend not to balance nicely. So, my advice would be, whenever you have an odd number here for the oxygen, just double it. And now we have six oxygens over here. If we have six oxygens over here, we can balance over there. But the first thing we notice we've messed up is with two of these all together, we now have two sulfur. On the left, we just have one lonely sulfur. So we're going to double this. And I believe in this particular case, that's good. It just balances. Okay, so now to the right of the equation, we are just going to say what delta H equals. Delta H equals. A few things we want to note. So NB, note bien. One, the reaction is exothermic. This produces heat. So delta H is going to be negative. And we need to make sure we remember that. But the other thing we need to remember we used two moles of SO2. So we must double the molar delta H. All right, and if you wanted to show this with dimensional analysis, you don't have to. My goodness, we know we can just double it. But just to show you that the math works, we could say we used two moles of SO2, and we know that there's negative 98.9 kilojoules used for every one mole of SO2. Right, that information comes from right here. And when we do that, moles of SO2 cancels with moles of SO2. And we end up with a delta H of what? Negative 1, it's going to be 190. Negative 197.8 kilojoules, I do believe. Yeah, I just used my calculator. So we can do that. We can say the delta H finally, when we have it calculated, is negative 197.8. And we would just write that right on here. And when we write it this way, we just write it next to the equation. Delta H equals negative 197.8. And it will always go to the right of the equation, whether it's positive or negative. In fact, to be honest, don't worry about it, but just to make mine really clear, I'll put like a little separation between the equation and the delta H itself. It's not part of the equation, it's next to the equation. It's sort of a variable you're declaring after the fact. Just like that. So, two ways with thermochemical equations. The first, just write the equation, just like that. But in the second case, we can write it right there. So I hope that's kind of clear. Now the third case is a little bit more esoteric, but I think you'll be fine with it, actually. I'm not too worried. The third example is what we call an energy level diagram. An energy level diagram is just an effective way visually to represent the delta H of an equation. It's a way to represent visually whether energy is leaving or coming into the equation. So if you go to the next page, we can take a look. So here we are, energy level diagrams. And we have two diagrams here, and I have not labeled them. But let's take a look at what we're looking at here. Let's look at the one on the left first. We have two H levels, two enthalpy levels, H1 and H2. So when we are measuring on here, this axis is enthalpy. This axis shows us how much internal energy, because remember, that's what enthalpy is a measure of. It's a measure of how much energy is inside of the compounds at any given time. And the letter for that, of course, is just H. So for example, when I label this one over here, I would just say that's H. And in fact, I might not label it at all. But here we have it labeled. And now that we have it labeled, the question is, what is this diagram showing us? Well, it's showing us that the reactants have high enthalpy, and the products have low enthalpy. And how different are they? Well, the space between them, the space from here to here, is how much it is changed by. And so this would be delta H, the enthalpy change. Now, in this reaction, what can we say? What do we learn in this reaction? And we're back. Sorry. I don't know how long that was out. I'll take a look after. But it's worth keeping in mind that that didn't go well. And so I think I have no choice but to say officially, that's chemistry 1, Mr. Orlando 2. That one was clunky. So sorry about that. So here we go. We're back. We can say in this case that the products definitely have less energy than the reactants. So the reactants have more energy than the products. And I'm just going to say then prod. What else can I say, though? So the reactants have more energy than the products. We could then say that heat is released. Right? To the environment. If the products have less energy, that energy had to go somewhere. And where it went was to the surrounding environment. So the reactants have more energy than the products because that heat is released to the environment. And we would call this exothermic. That above is an example of an exothermic reaction. What would happen to the temperature? Megan is, of course, completely correct, and I know that she shouted out. She's always shouting answers out. The temperature would go up. Good. With that in mind, let's look at this example over here. Here, we again have a change in enthalpy, and in fact, the change in enthalpy is of the same magnitude. This arrow is as big as that arrow. This is covering the same distance as that. Though in this case, the reactants have low energy and the products have high energy. Just like that. So what can we say? We can say products have more energy. So these chemicals end up with more energy than they started with. Where did that energy come from? So energy is absorbed from the environment. That energy had to come from heat that used to be in the environment, but it was absorbed from the environment. This is, of course, an endothermic reaction. And what would we, or what would one observe if one were observing this reaction? Well, the temperature the temperature would decrease. So the gap between these levels represents the change in enthalpy. And in this case, again, this isn't going to be a graph where I put a scale on here because that would involve knowing what H11 is and H2 was. We don't, but we can know what the change is. And so I could always put a number here. And this, again, is a visual way to show that energy can be changed. So show an energy level diagram of the reaction of magnesium and oxygen with delta H of negative 601.6 and the hydrolysis of water with a different delta H. So we'll do one together and then you can do the second by yourself. So the first, the reaction between magnesium and oxygen. Let's look at that first. Magnesium, which is a solid, reacts with oxygen, which is a gas. Anyone gonna yell at me? Anybody? Don't think I won't make you stand from home. Oxygen is, of course, diatomic. What's this going to make as a product? Well, we could jump to the margins and say magnesium, if we look it up on the periodic table, takes a charge of 2+. And oxygen takes a charge of 2-. And so we end up with MgO, because that's a perfect charge balance. So we don't need more magnesium or more oxygen. One magnesium ion will perfectly charge balance one oxygen ion. We end up with MgO. And I'm done, and that's perfect, right? Oh, I'm being told by oh, I don't know, let's say Blaze, that this doesn't balance. So I need a 2 there and a 2 there for this to balance out. Good. And if I wanted to, I could put that there. Keep in mind, because it's 2 magnesium, I actually have to be careful to double this number. Delta H is negative, so this energy is absorbed or released. Who can tell me? Yeah, it's released. And remember, it is doubled because I've used 2 moles of magnesium. So in this case, we are going to release 1,203.2 kilojoules. I've just doubled that number. And I have chosen to do this first in the style of part one, a thermochemical equation that just includes the energy, which is one of the options. Now, instead, if I wanted to draw this as an energy level diagram, I would just mark that as H. And I would note that if energy is released, is this going to look like this, where the reactants have this much energy and the products have that much? Or is it going to look like this? And we can refer to our note above and say, oh, right, in an endothermic reaction, like this second one, we end up with more energy. But in an exothermic reaction, where energy is released, the products have less energy at the end. We end up with low energy products, low enthalpy products. So we're going to start with 2mg plus O2 as our reactants, and we can write them in there. And our products will look like this, and it will be 2mgO. And we can mark the delta H right in there. And again, remember, even though we show it as added here because it's in the reaction, the actual delta H is negative, and it's negative 1203.2. For this particular reaction. If you wished to use a fractional oxygen, like we said, that would be okay too. You could say magnesium plus half of an oxygen reacts to give you MgO, and then you could list that delta H as negative 601.6. There's nothing wrong with that. These are both correct. I like the one on the left. I like nicely balanced chemical equations, but there's nothing technically wrong with using a fractional O2. That's an accepted thing, but I prefer the one on the left. All right, you try the hydrolysis of water. And if you don't remember what the hydrolysis of water is, talk to one another. I think you will remember it. If you were with me last semester, we did it as a little lab, a little mini lab that you did. All right, I'll assume that you paused the video and we're back. The hydrolysis of water. Well, if you remember, hydrogen and oxygen together gives us water. And if we take liquid water and we do what with it? Well, in the lab, if you remember, what did we do? If you remember in the lab, we took containers of water and we put an electrical current through them. And when we put an electrical current through them, we ended up with gases forming. Hydrogen gas over here, oxygen gas over there. When we did that, we had to put electricity through it, which means we had to put energy into it. And so if we had to put energy into it, that tells us right there that the reaction is endothermic, which means we had to put that energy in right here. And the numbers tell us that it took 285.5 kilojoules of energy. And when we did that, this thing breaks down, and it breaks down into its parts, and it gives us hydrogen gas, and it gives us oxygen. Oh, no. Oh, no, but don't forget that oxygen is diatomic. So there's two ways to approach this, and neither one is right, neither one is wrong. Take a minute and see if you can figure out what the two ways are. In fact, show off to me. See if you can come up with both of them. All right, we're back. One of the ways you could solve this, we said that fractional oxygens are allowed, that you can do that. So I could just say we get half of an oxygen molecule, half a mole of oxygen. And that works. That is allowed. It's not my preferred thing, not how I love it, but that does work. The other option, of course, is we could just double these two. The only thing you have to keep in mind is if we double how much water we've electrolyzed, we're going to have to double the amount of water required. And so we'd have to double this. And we should get 571 kilojoules of energy that we would have to put in to make this reaction happen. Again, I don't care which of those solutions you need, and you would not need to write them both. But that works. Energy level diagram? Well, this time, when we start out with water, we're going to have to put energy into that water to get our products. And our products, remember, are hydrogen gas and half of an oxygen gas. And how much energy did we have to put in? Well, we had to put in 285.5 kilojoules. And that's positive because the amount of energy is going up. And if you would rather draw that for the one where you balanced it by doubling the water, no problem. Just go ahead and do that. I'm not going to draw both. I'm going to call it a day there. All right. And that's it. So here we are. For those of you keeping score at home, the final score was Mr. Orlando 2, Chemistry 1. I won. As well as I'd like, but I did win. Caleb, be quiet. I've left you with a little bit of practice for this. I want you to work on it again tomorrow. You are going to get your first assignment package of Unit 3, and it's going to have some practice questions for this. I forgot to take the lab books home to Mark, for which I apologize. The flip side to that being, if you hadn't got it into me, I don't know that you're late, and I encourage you to get it done and hand it in today so that when I get to school tomorrow and I mark all of them, it will be a mystery to me that you dodged your work. All right, that's all. Have a wonderful day. Be kind to one another. Don't do anything that Mr. Calford wouldn't do, let's say, hypothetically. And I will see all y'all tomorrow. All right. Ciao.